give some background. So I'm going to start because, as I say, Miko has a long car ride this afternoon, so the sooner you get started, the better, happier it's going to be. The inspiration for talking about this is two things. A necessity of finding somebody to talk this Friday, because Mary Walshaw can't come until the 28th. Not the 28th, the 5th. The 20th was the one she couldn't come. So May 5th, Mary will be coming. And there was nobody to speak. And after the lab meeting last week, Angela asked me, because later on I was going to talk about the LCHC autobiography, and I'm not actually going to talk about that today. But she asked that, because it's 15 chapters long and it covers about 50 years, it's like a lot to read and people are very busy. And so if we were going to have a session on it, the question is, what might there be themes in there that people could go through, or you know, something that would focus things more and make it easier for people, busy people, to join in a discussion about it. From those discussions, I started to think about the different styles of research, particularly those that have occurred in the last 15 years or so in the lab. But as I went over the history, I can see that it's like a long tendency, like a drift. Maybe directionless, but I don't think so. I think it's being pulled by something. In which the way in which researchers gather their research, and in particular the relationship between the person doing the observing. I'm going to use observer and researcher pretty much in this case, as synonyms for each other. And one doesn't have to, you can split those out, but I'm going to. And so I thought about that, and I said to Angela, I knew that she's was not only leaving town, but she had a deadline for grants and stuff. So I thought I would talk this week, and then simultaneously, so I want to solve several problems. I want to give a possible path through looking at this for later on. But I also really actually wanted to model for people what it means to come in here and give a half-baked talk. Because I had no damn time at all, other than my thinking about it, talked a little bit with Angela about it. I thought about it a little bit during the week. I sat down this morning and I typed out a list. So it's that amount of preparation. And that's a tradition of bringing in ideas and then using the group as a zone of proximal development, where I can talk and imagine like I'm making sense, you can try to make sense of it, and afterward maybe we'll make more sense and I'll develop. So then you put the microphone and everything on me, and it makes it very hard to be informal. I'm just going to pretend. So if we start off, Harry, if you bring up, so this is the autobiography that I'm talking about, and there's a kind of introduction here, and it says, look at all the lab's research. But the next one actually has a header that I wanted people to look at, because it is a picture that captures certain features of the earliest work of the laboratory, sort of the precursors of the laboratory in the cross-cultural research that we did in West Africa, where I was called in as an expert, so-called, in mathematical psychology. Kids were having trouble learning math, and somebody confused doing mathematical psychology with understanding how children acquire math, and they had no relationship with each other at all. But I ended up then trying to figure out, well, what was the problem with these kids doing that? And I was part of a team. Everybody understood that this requires anthropologists and psychologists. And I was the experimental psychologist who was sent to do that. And there's an even, you know, this picture is important. Can you pull up the section one picture, I think? Yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't. It's a picture itself.
Which one? Just the picture itself?
Picture of section one. Click on section one. So this gives you an idea of what I would think the initial starting point would be. If we can get, it comes up very slowly. First it has to check for everything. This is UCSD security. Right? So there's a pretty good picture of the relationship of the observer to the observed. I thought it catches that. Not bad in the West African work. If somebody, if there are pictures in the autobiography of flying into this little tiny village where the people had to cut down the termite hills in the middle of the field in order for us to land, like out of nowhere landing, and then somebody walks up and does that to somebody else. There's an observer from them, really from the, completely from the outside. And then the next picture is one of the things that such an observer might do when you walked into the village. And the history of the next picture, if you go back to the picture of the woman doing the puzzle, I think it's chapter 1 picture. Yeah, this picture. So there are pictures of me squatting in the dirt. This picture, Jim, is a picture of a woman who's trying to do a 5-piece jigsaw puzzle of 3 colors, and she's trying to place a piece in a way that violates both the color scheme and the frame of the puzzle. And she does this for about 1.5 minutes.
I'm looking at the picture.
Oh, you can see it. Okay, good. Okay, that's great. So one of the things, like the first thing I did when I went to the library is I got very sick from the shots they gave me. And I was lying around and there are kids there and I like to do jigsaw puzzles. And I did jigsaw puzzles. And the kids were blown away by my ability to do the jigsaw puzzles. And Peace Corps workers said, oh, these kids can't do jigsaw puzzles. And I'm going, oh, come on. They have perceptual deficits. They had all these explanations for why they couldn't do this kind of thing. So we went and bought the simplest form of a puzzle we could find. We turned it over and we put these very obvious colors on it. The experiment initially presented the puzzle whole, so that they could see that it was a square, just as an attempt to see that it was a square, and then have them taken apart and have them put it back together. And it took 2 or 3 minutes for an average adult to do that the first time. They learned some pretty rapidly. But here, it's as if the person doing this is completely outside the frame of what we're talking about. And so whatever we see is like the obvious frame of the square is simply not operating for the person. And it's a kind of metaphor for a lot of the problems of taking, if you're doing a sorting task and people sort things where there's 2 or 5 and they're red or green and they're triangles or squares. And people have difficulty doing that. And if a child here had difficulty doing that, you would put them in protective service, some kind of, you'd worry about them a lot. And these are perfectly normal adults who are living perfectly normal lives, doing all sorts of stuff, so you wonder about that. So this experimentation from the outside. And when you do this kind of thing, even if you do things like, instead of doing using geometric figures, you use colors of rice that have local meanings that can be categorized, people have a great deal of difficulty understanding what you're talking about dividing them into 2 that are all the same and different from the ones in the other pile. And they do that, and then you say, can you do it a different way? And they just, it doesn't come easy. It's not clear to them what it is that you're talking about. Now, this way of approaching things has a long, you know, really long history of how experimentation works. You create an artificial condition of some kind or some phenomenon in nature in order to assess it, to see, to try to figure out how the thing works. And very often that can have produce very, really important information. So when Rutherford, a physicist, creates a little cloud chamber, which is hard to come by walking around, right? And he shoots an electric pulse through that and can be able, if you see the disturbance, to be able to see that atoms are there, that kind of experimental manipulation is extremely informative about the way things are working around you. And so it's not like they're idiots who go off and try to do the totally trying to do this kind of thing. The issue is, are you destroying the phenomena you're trying to look at by the way in which you're trying to observe? And I'll contrast, and C. Wright Mills in his book, The Sociological Imagination, refers this to as abstract empiricism. It's abstract in the sense that you have from somewhere abstracted out certain properties that you want to test, and you actually go and you test whether those properties work. But to do that, you need this kind of artificial situation to isolate the properties that you want. I'm going to contrast that with what I don't know that he ever makes up a term, but I'm going to call it grounded empiricism for the moment, right? And the example of this is the work that we did with measuring rice with the same people. So it's also said the people, they can't measure, they only have a number system with one, few, many, which isn't true. But there are all sorts of explanations for difficulties with kids doing measuring and what have you. We're working with adults. And we would spend time at the market. Go to the market, people are trading fish of all different kinds, there's money being exchanged, and rice. And rice comes in these sort of bowls. People have rice in bowls that they sell, and the amount of rice that they have is a standard tin can, a sardine can, a pint can. Rice is grown by these people as a subsistence crop. It's extraordinarily central to their everyday lives to be able to deal with rice and amounts of rice. And so we created a little task where we took the stuff that we observed in the market, where women selling rice, and we put different amounts of rice in bowls, and we asked people to estimate how many cups of rice were there. We did it in Liberia. We did it in New Haven, Connecticut. We did it with Yalies as well as local townspeople. And the local Yalies looked like total idiots compared to the people in Liberia. Okay? So it starts like starting from as far as you can. You're still, in a sense, you're still outside observer, but you picked up on an indigenous practice. And then the thing you're asking people to do is like a model of that practice. Right? So I think, and that idea we had in embryonic form that grew over a period of time. But it's still the case that if you're me in Liberia, you are the other in along enormous number of dimensions. Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
So what did they, you alluded to the fact that there was like a different measuring system of, right? Like, so what did you ask the people to do that made the people in Connecticut look like idiots compared to the...
Nothing, we just gave them a task to carry out estimating amounts of rice.
Oh, estimating rice, okay.
Right. And they were accurate in estimating amounts of rice. It's no big deal, except that the aliens look really idiotic, and then it makes you stop and think.
Because
what the hell are we doing with the puzzle?
Yeah.
What were we doing with the puzzle?
Right.
So it's in. Are you in other people's frame, or are you outside the other people's frame when you're trying to do that? Okay, so the major application of this kind of work is in two areas. One had to do with education, and the other had to do with indigenous literacy practices among a group of people who didn't go to school, but had a writing system. And what we've set out to, in this case, was to figure out using psychological experiments. But now, absolutely modeled upon the local practices with the form of literacy that people engaged in. And again, here, in this case, with respect to schooling, we began to realize, right about then, right, that schooling and these psychological tasks, where did they come from in the first place? They came from efforts to have samples of what kids learn in school. By Binet and Simon, that's what they started out to do. They wanted to be able to make schooling effective for everybody. And they created these little tasks that are modeled on the kinds of things that the kids are asked to do in school to see whether or not the kids were good at doing it. And then to try and help those kids who weren't. That was the idea. It's never worked out that way, but that was the idea. So we began to see, like, you have these two poles. On the one hand, you have psychological experiments, the form of which and the content of which is specifically the form and content of the schooling that these kids have undergone for hours and hours and hours, right? And you have, in some kind of contrast with that, the everyday activities in which elements of the stuff that is available in school are assembled in different ways for people to go about doing their work. And if you want to figure out what they're learning or what they know or how they generalize or anything else, you better, at a very minimum, now start to treat the experiment as a model of everyday practices. So that's kind of still, the observer is still an outsider to this system, but not as much of an outsider, drawing more upon indigenous practices and hoping that the you don't totally blow things by larger parts of the frame that you don't understand. Then the next thing I thought about was the way in which we move from being observers to being participants at different times. And I haven't worked this all out, but I have some rough examples to think with, and then maybe all of these could be scaled in some way, I don't know. There's a rough continuum here. And the examples here, well, have to do with what happened when I came back. I was working at Rockefeller University, and this problem of the relationship between experiments and the domains of life of the world that you want to generalize what you see in an experiment to is referred to as the problem of ecological validity of psychological experiments. To what extent does the content and form of the thing that you're using as a test, is it representative of what goes on in other places, or is it only that you're going to ever see the thing right here? And if so, you better be careful about how you generalize. So we're very worried about the tendency to generalize experimental results based upon experimentation that does not sample what people do. But we had, Africa was a terrible place to study such things. We didn't know the language. It's like, why would you go there to do that? You don't have to do that there. How about a room about a little bit bigger than this room? Share it with George Miller, who's got little kids coming in, and drape it with microphones and put video cameras on it. Also, look at what the kids are doing when they're in their classrooms. Same kids. You have a group of kids and you look at them in their classroom. There you're just an observer from the outside looking at the scene that's going on, but you're watching what individual kids are doing. You're using video to back you up so that you can check out what your impressions are. And that was the first time that we actually did something after school. And what we wanted to do was to go to something that is closer to every day. Now, an after school nature club or cooking club on the third floor of a Rockefeller building is not exactly the everyday world, but it's way different than the classroom, right? And among other things, the kids don't have to, this is gonna be a very important theme, that when experimenters tell people what to do, they are supposed to do what it is that they're told. They're there, they're being paid. If if you study kids in classrooms and you give them tests, they're not in classrooms and not taking your test voluntarily. They would prefer to be doing something else. So you're dealing with somebody who's having to squeeze himself into your frame in order to be able to respond to it. And if they resist, that resistance is recorded as negative performance. It's not recorded as doing something else, it's recorded as negative performance on the thing that you presented. But the problem is you don't know what they're doing. Right? So you really don't know how to generalize from observations of that kind. And this is an idea that I took initially from Alexander Luria, who did experiments where he said the way you know what another person is thinking is to get highly coordinated and voluntary activity and then be able to predict when there's a discoordination. And when that happens, you'll know, oh, I don't know what that person is thinking. Or in this case, you rig it so you actually know the thing they're trying not to tell you. It was linked to lie detectors and went off in a lot of bullshit directions, but principle is extremely important. You want the little kids there voluntarily, so when they screw up, it's not because they're trying to do something else or give you a hard time. It's because they're trying like hell, but they can't do it. And then you have an opportunity to see what the problem is. But if they're not there voluntarily, you just can't tell. And we've all experienced the ambiguity. Harry's a teacher, and we've experienced the tremendous ambiguity that situation creates. So what we did to study ecological validity was we compared what the kids did on tests that we gave them. We hired a teacher from the schools to give them tests. We observed them in their classroom, and then we ran these two after-school clubs, a nature club and a cooking club. And we created we just videotaped. And then we watched for occasions to see how did the cakes get baked? Who did the reading? What was like these? And like, what was going on here, right? We were looking, what was the hell was going on here? There's enough structure in that so maybe you can see things. But the first day we ran this cooking club, the first time the kids had been there, there was a lot of coming and going, whatever, and the cakes bloody well got baked. And I walked, and Ray McDermott and others were behind this one-way mirror, looking at the whole thing. I said, "Can you see cognitive tasks happening? That's what we were looking for, finding cognitive tasks when you didn't make them happen." They said, "We didn't see a single one." They were sitting there, look, they were looking. They couldn't see it. So it took going back to the tapes, and it took occasions in which one kid was missing from a coordinated group, or it took special occasions we could see the social order being put together, and we could see cognitive tasks in some sense happening, kids doing it or not doing it. But it wasn't that we made the kids do it. And it was not, and the kids all had a great time, and we always made, part of the answer is, we always made sure the kids had some cake to take home when they left.
So basically they were there voluntarily, right? And
sure.
Then all that you told them was like, here's a recipe, make a cake, and then,
well,
or you didn't even tell them.
No, we went through stages of doing this, but on the first day we said, we're gonna bake a cake, and the big deal was, they had to settle who was going to be paired with whom. Until they settled the pairing of the social organization, nothing else happened. And I ended up with the one big troublemaker that all the other kids didn't want to deal with. He was my partner. Okay, and that was all arranged, and it took us a year to figure that out. And that just was the documentation. Okay, I don't, you know, time is flying and I don't want to run over. So. Another kind of thing we did there was to, with preschool kids from a Harlem preschool, where almost no conversation went on, just from its observers. We have a videotape where we're there for 20 minutes, and it's time to make baskets to take home for Easter, and all the kids are being quiet, sitting at the table, waiting for the teachers to finish making the baskets for the kids. And there's just no talk going on at all. So when we were there, we did a variety of things, but one of the things that Jill McNamee did, a Hampshire student who was there and working with us, was to put little kids two at a time in the shopping cart and take them to the market. Put a tape recorder in the shopping cart with them and record what they said. And then ask them to tell about it when they came back. And then to take the recording to the speech, to use speech act theory to as a coding scheme, and then to compare, according to speech acts, what kind of talk went on at the supermarket and in the classroom. And we were going off of work that Bill LeBove had done on radically changing the circumstances of conversation for little kids. And our conclusions actually were, I don't think, taken seriously by people. The conclusion overall was the kids used a lot more language and a lot more complicated language in the supermarket than they did in the classroom. LeBove was right about that. But what he didn't pick up on at the level of analysis he was doing, and he didn't do multiple. We did experimentation along with whatever the other weirdness was that we were doing, is that the big difference happened because in the supermarket the kids could say things, declare things, point out things, and talk about what interested them. Whereas when they came back, they had to talk about what they had done somewhere else. And what happened, so that if you looked at the rare times in the classroom, the kids declared something, it was about as long as it was in the supermarket, but it changes the entire nature of the discourse it changed. And you move from one place to the other. So again, we're not the guy with the camera taking a picture of this poor befuddled woman that holding a child, right? We're much more into the situation than we were before, but we're still outsiders and that inside outside thing is going to be important. I think that the next important step in all of that resulted because we were successful in surprising ourselves at Rockefeller University, because we had a kid who was all the kids were devilish at times, but this kid could be very helpful and organize up people, and things got done when he was around and doing things. And I went over after a few months, because I didn't want to contaminate what I knew from the after school with what was going on in the school classroom. But after, like, Christmas time or something, I went to see the teacher. I knew that my kids had gone to that school. And she said, "How's it going?" I said, "Hey, it's going great." She said, "Is Alex giving you a problem?" What? "No, Richard's giving me a problem." That's the little kid I ended up with the first day. "But Alex is fine." She said, "You didn't know he's learning disabled." Wait now. I just spent like several sessions with this kid, and he was like the other kids, but he could organize up things, and like I didn't. And we had to go back to the tape again, right? So I think, I don't want to dwell on that, but what happened as a result of that is that we got a bundle of money from the Bureau of Educationally Handicapped to go look at the situational variability of the expression of so-called learning disabilities. And we had it all worked out with school here, and we were going to be observers. That was our plan. We were going to do our video thing again and be observers. We had an agreement from the principal. The teachers thought it was a fine idea. We were going to follow the kids out on the playground. We were going to go home with them on the weekends. We were going to study this distribution of when these problems arose. Except that after about two or three sessions of being taped, the teachers who had been handed a group of, Bud Meehan was involved in this research. We did tests on the kids, so we had our own independent assessments of whatever it was that we brought the kids to be in this classroom. They were an extremely heterogeneous group, and the teachers were not being successful. And we were videotaping them. And they wanted to hold on to their jobs, I think. And so they asked us, "Please, would you take your video cameras away, and basically, would you please go away?" Uh-oh, so we're into October, and we've taken this money, and people have been hired for the year, and our research thing just went gone. And so Bud Meehan and Peg Griffin, who was a part of the lab, a very important part of the lab for many years, decided on the way home, I think it was Peg who decided, not Bud, Bud just went along with it probably, decided that we would run an after-school program, and we would take the kids that were the bottom 20% of their classroom, not just those kids, and that we would run an after-school reading curriculum. And that changed our relationship to the subject a lot, because the after-school stuff at Rockefeller, we were responsible for the kids' safety, not to do any harm, but we weren't instructed, we weren't tutoring, we weren't responsible for taking kids. We weren't responsible for getting this kid who was so-called learning disabled to be able to read. That's just not what we were doing. So we had minimal kind of responsibility. Now you take kids in, we're failing. We took the bottom 20% because the teachers' union contract said that the teachers had to show progress with 80% of the children. So we said, "See, the other 20%, so we can't do, how much harm can we do? School's failing. We'll keep them after school, but it has to be voluntary. If they want to go home, they can go home." So it was very clear. And if kids had, you know, started to totally disrupt the group, so you don't really don't have to be here. We do want to go home. And kids generally didn't want to go home, but we did take kids home a couple times because we genuinely meant we did want them there if they didn't want to be there. And that was a really big change. And I think the research that we did out of that produced a really deeper understanding of the reading process. It was replicated then by, because it couldn't be a true experiment, but we did. It was all, there are many different treatments mixed together, and lots of stuff was going on, you couldn't tell. But we had one procedure that really seemed to grab the kids, and it seemed to teach us a lot about the individual kids. So we wanted to continue to work with that. And that in doing that, we had a graduate, and this is, became very common. A graduate student, Katie King, took the procedure that we worked out there, and she did a true experiment with kids up at a school, for school, with kids who were not learning how to read, and ran it against two other control group where we just kept the kids happy, and another one where they, other researchers who were doing research said, this is a great technique, and sure enough, the technique that we wanted to, that we had devised, was really effective. Right? Now, so that's, again, we're not throwing away experimentation that has no role in what you're doing, but it's being built out of this other well of information about what it is that's going on. It was in that context, along with the reading groups that we had to have the kids there voluntarily after school, and the reading groups were okay, sort of, but boy, it could be fun if you could play with computers. There was Apple IIs. Jim was our guru of doing Apple II computers. And we brought in the computers. We were going to use one of Jim's games. It wasn't running at the time. And the kids brought in Pac-Man and other stuff like that. And it was extraordinarily embarrassing to us. And the teachers would walk in and say, what are you doing, sensory motor training on these kids? And it was like really acutely embarrassing. And over Easter vacation, Peg Griffin basically came up with the solution, which was the basic idea of the fifth dimension. And the idea there was to embed this whole thing in a fantasy world, to provide an opportunity for kids to play computer games, but not to play them in a way that was mindless, to start to insert as a part of the activity that reading and writing and arithmetic might be a part of what we're doing as you played that game, embedded within a fantasy world metaphor. With a wizard who lives backwards in time and has a bad memory, and all the other fol-de-rol of the fantasy stuff that we put in order, and again, working after school. And at this point, Bud and I really, I think the after school experience made Bud uncomfortable because the rest of the kids could misbehave. And we did a summer school here, which I can still remember going down Torrey Pines Grade with kids to do an activity, and the kids are going crazy in the back of the car, and Bud is perspiring, we're both as hot, we're both perspiring, and Bud is just like, oh, it's very hard. And I can put up with that chaos. But, and he's a sociologist and has continued to work in the schools, but I've been very biased to working after school because of the potential to be with children and undergraduates and adults in a different way than it's ever going to be possible, except in the most extraordinary classrooms. So there we were for going, I put that down as for being for participant to responsibility for instruction. So you're kind of in a teacher role when you do that. And then there was a fifth dimension that grew out of that. And the fifth dimension was now again an opportunity, we thought, to do research that would allow us to be with the kids, study the phenomena we wanted to study under even more propitious conditions in some ways. So we began there to really mix play with anything that looked like it was at all educational, to the point where the kids could not tell at any given time. If it was a Pac-Man game, then in order to succeed, they had to do something that was more instructional. And if it was an instructional game, they had to do something that was more fantastic and fun, right? So that at any given time, they just, it was very hard for them to tell. It's just that we created an environment where the basic rule was the kids have to be having a good time and you have to be having a good time, or you have to change the way things are going until you're both having a good time. Otherwise, it wouldn't happen. Otherwise, you can't make any observations. But now you're in there. What is that? You're a participant. You're not an instructor. You're not just an adult coordinator of something. And well, yeah, maybe you are. So you're this adult in that situation. Now, however, you've introduced undergraduates into it. And the undergraduates remix all the power relations that are going on in the situation that you have. And now you use the field notes of the undergraduates and their accounts of their encounters to give you a point of view that's as close to level to the undergraduates, to the children as you can get. And the 7 and 8 year olds were totally confused about the undergraduates. Is your mommy gonna pick you up? They would say to some of the kids, the undergraduates over there, right? So it was like when my wife used to babysit the kids, they had such a good time that when I came, it was like her daddy was coming together, right? And that was the condition of the environment that we were aiming for. Because the kids had lots of just play stuff to do right outside. They didn't have to be there, and they could walk. The door was open, and they could walk out. So if they were there, they were there. Okay, well, for a bunch of reasons, there are shortcomings to doing research that way as well. And one of them is that you've created an activity that is exogenous to the institution that has taken it in. And part of the interest with the fifth dimension was and remains, to what extent will it be taken up by the institutions that put it together? So I don't want to really actually get into a big discussion about the fifth dimension, but the fifth dimension requires that we have undergraduate classes. We provide undergraduates there because it's part of the design of the activity. And therefore you have to have an organization that will supervise them, provide the kids, provide facilities and so on. And you have to go through all of the problems of dealing with the University of California in San Diego so that you have a steady flow of students there and it doesn't overwhelm. And that's an important topic, but we can get into it if we have time, if people want to. What I wrote down there is from designer coordinator, which is kind of what I think we had been when we did the ecological validity thing, we sort of did it, to a designer, but where your role when you're there as an adult researcher at least is pretty much a coordinator. You're not an authority figure. Only in the most distance weird sense. You know, your professor, you can't, no matter how much I would play the old fool, I could not be Professor Cole, right? And so the design experimentation line, I think we took as far as we really wanted to take it with the fifth dimension work. And when the Boys and Girls Club closed and the fifth dimension had to move, we learned an enormous amount because of how much had been invested in our institutional relations, because we went into a Boys and Girls Club where the head of the Boys and Girls Club had been at the previous club and invited us to come in, and after 10 weeks we had gone. We could not make the fifth dimension work in this other environment. Whole other story, all very interesting, but it shows you something about the relationship of the observer to the observed because of the institutional arrangements that make it possible for the observer to be there. Who the hell got me in the middle of Liberia in an airplane? Right? It's not in the picture that John Gay took of that woman, I'll tell you. All right, so that really led us then to Town and Country and what we ended up calling mutual appropriation. And when we went in there, we were not going, first of all, we weren't going to do it. Right? We thought it was impossible, physically impossible to do it there because of where it is. I said, that's just crazy, we can't take students down there. But it turned out at that time, although the conditions are always changing in this kind of research, at that time, if you left here at 3 o'clock, you'd be there by 3:30. Right? You could walk out of this office and be there in half an hour. And it turned out that you could be back in half an hour as well. And that we were asked to do this by the people in charge there, and they picked out Miss Beverly and Town and Country as a place that we could try it. And all we did was to walk in and say, "What can we do? What would you like us to do?" And we were interested in activities with kids and how kids learn and so on. But we were there to. And my biggest memory is of this box full of blue wires, which Yvonne started to work on to disentangle what the hell was going on, because there really was no internet in there that worked. And that was how Town and Country, that was how Town and Country began. Now, over time, what happened to Town and Country was that there was always homework as a thing that had to be dealt with, but then there was all this other kind of time. And in that other kind of time, you needed to create activity. We had theories about the organization of educational activities for children. And what you had to do, though, was to create educational activities that the kids wanted to participate in. And that led to various forms of research that went on that were conducted primarily by graduate students and were dissertations in psychology or communication or wherever it was appropriate for them to get a PhD in. And I thought probably worthwhile would be to mention two. I'm going to talk about Camille's research, but I want to talk about Robert Lecusay's research. Because, and then Yvonne Rosera did research there, Rachel Cody's research with kids fit very well with her research program with kids, and she did research on World of Warcraft and teenagers and stuff that fit in with her research profile. So different graduate students who participated in making up the activities then picked up some piece of that activity, and it became the topic of a thesis, because it was not something that not everybody could do it. It required concentration, and besides which, somebody would find it interesting if you did. Somebody cared about that issue. In the case of Robert's issue, it was a real interest in a partnership with people. At the time, The white papers out of Washington were saying, in order to leverage after-school time for education, which is, we've written about a lot about school-invaded after-schools, stuff like that. But in order to make after-school really powerful, what we need to do is to get high-speed internet into all the after-school centers, and that will take care of the problem. And we knew, dead to rights, we knew that was horseshit, right? That once it got there, there was that tangle of blue wires that was just waiting at the other end, and you had to have activities to do. And how could you project that? Through Skype? To kids or to sitting? No, probably not. Under what conditions could you do it? And so Robert got together with Noah Finkelstein, who is a physicist, who became a physics educator at Boulder, and works with people like Bill Penwell and Chris Gutierrez and others when Chris was there. And Noah had been a postdoc, and he'd done physics, very interesting physics after school work here at the lab at an earlier time. And they came up with a particular physics curriculum, and they wanted to see if they could make it work in Town and Country. And so what Robert did was to create a hybrid activity that leveraged all the cultural resources and the sort of customs and ways of doing things that had developed in Town and Country. More kids could walk in when you were doing stuff. Kids could come and give advice. The kids made stop motion animation videos that they could then show. So it had a lot of properties of the kinds of things that would engage kids, but within which Robert could understand what was the potential at all of how might you think about after school, but could you put science, could you put STEM activity into that, and what would you learn about doing that? So that was one example, and Robert followed another line of work in the lab to get it. So he could have gotten work off of that work if he'd written it up. But before he had time to write it up, other work that he'd done, which I had passed over, but which is in the last section also of the autobiography. So this is this thread that you can pull through the autobiography. These are all things in the end of the autobiography. That one of the chapters in section 5 is about a form of preschool play in which the adults participate as major characters. And so it just blew the relationship between adults and kids in this situation. It's called Play Worlds. I think it's absolutely fascinating because the adults got so immersed, they did the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe up at Camp Pendleton. the teacher that they worked with in a kindergarten, first grade mixed classroom was totally into what it was that they were doing. And they created this alternative set of things where these, after two sessions, Kelly Moore, you all know Tough Kelly Moore? I hired her to go out because the people who were doing this research were so taken up with what they were doing that they were getting inappropriately emotional in laboratory meetings when they talked about it. They would laugh and cry and behave in ways where you thought, what's going on here? So I hired Tough Kelly Moore, and I said, you can't drive up there with them, and you can't drive down there, back here. You have to be an observer completely from the outside, and I want your field notes on what the hell happened in that session, because I don't understand what's going on. The only problem was that after the second session, Kelly Moore is up there in the preschool, and she's crying. Okay, so there's that's described in one of the chapters in there about that line of research. And Robert got a tenure track job, not a tenure track, he got tenure and a really, really good job so he could do that kind of research in Sweden. And that's where he's still there doing that kind of research. But the research that he did here was really valuable and should be written up because people are still bullshitting about what you're supposed to do about air in school in the same way they were doing it before. And then I'll get to Camille's work. So Camille's work came up in a different way, and it wasn't carried out at Town and Country. And Camille's here, she's gonna correct me, and then I'm gonna talk a little bit about Angela's thesis research. You guys then can straighten me out when we get down to the living people here. So you can judge how badly I did with the other accounts, how badly I did with yours. So Camille got concerned, we were all concerned, but Camille got involved in the problem of the kids' safety at Town and Country when they went to school. In particular, when they walked down Imperial Boulevard and had to either go up to Gompers or get over to Lincoln. And there were some very unpleasant incidents that were happening along the way, and she got involved, and she and I went to a parents' meeting to tell the parents about Town and Country. So this is, again, embedding yourself in ways as an experimenter. What am I doing at a PTA meeting about people who are like, they don't need to do that to be experiments. But there we heard about this group, Project Safeway, which is worried about the safety of the kids. And Camille and Makiba Jones, who worked to create and was involved at Lincoln at the time and at Gompers, they got involved with Project Safeway, which was run out of the local Jacobs Family Foundation, philanthropy, tries to do good things in the neighborhood. And she spent time going out on standing on street corners and going to the meetings at the Jacobs Family Center and getting to know the people. And it turns out this project idea comes up. They want people to know about what Project Safeway is doing, and wouldn't it be nice to have a video to go around and show people in the community about Project Safeway as a way of mobilizing community support? And these people who were doing Project Safeway thought, that's a cat's meow. That would be really great to have a thing like that, but how are we going to do it? Camille says, well, I know how to do that, so I can help you. And so she goes and gives them cameras and interviews people, and they make videos, and whoever the they is, days that she's met, and then at a certain point they collected a bunch of videos, time to produce a thing. They got too much video. Well, there's all this video. So you're gonna have to edit it down. As you start to edit it down, people start to get left out. And you have to make decisions. So you're talking in the editing room about, well, why are you gonna put this and not this? Why are you doing this? Oh, we forgot to include so-and-so. Gotta have that person in here, right? We don't have any video. So you had to go out and shoot new stuff. And as you start to narrow down to what the final product is gonna be, all the stuff that was going on in the community around you that you just couldn't see at all, it was just not visible to you at all, right? It starts to come on the table in public of who's being excluded and why, who's being included and why, and you now start to understand what's going on in that community a whole hell of a lot better than you did before you started helping these people make a film about what they wanted to do. And the people get the film. And the film actually is a pretty damn good film. And they can go off and show it to people and get people to think that it's a good thing. Right? So it achieves one of the I think it's one of the rare achievements in all the bullshit about participatory action research, in which the people who are the object of research actually get out of it what they wanted out of it. And Camille got a PhD from the University of California, San Diego. Okay? And I think she was positioned, I think that was a very interesting positioning. Of course, it's a very well-kept secret. She's saving this for her grandchildren, right? Okay, so, and then then I started thinking about about Angela's research and her thesis. And I don't know quite what the name is. So I wrote down here, observer as role player in existing social institutions. Okay. So, but here's my description of how.
My dissertation?
What?
Yeah. That sounds fun. Getting participation rights was the.
Okay.
Was the name.
Well, I didn't remember that, but
that's
that,
I,
right.
But I understand why you went that route.
Right. So because where I'm trying to go with this is that in all the research that I've talked about, the relationship between the observer, the researcher, and the people being researched is in some sense designed by the researcher. If the researcher wasn't there doing it, wouldn't happen. Right? It turns out the thing that Angela did in her thesis, if Angela wasn't there doing it what she did, somebody else would have been there doing what she did, and the institution is still, it was there before she got there, and it's going to be there, it's there now. And it's probably going to be there for a long time, however it functions, right? So she, as a graduate student, gets hired on by a nonprofit agency that has responsibility for supporting a youth action, a youth student advisory board, which in the charter of the city of Oakland or the school system of Oakland is supposed to be able to sit on school board meetings as a non-voting member and but give their opinions. And her research was one in which she had to, in the terms of the participants, locate herself such that she was fulfilling her institutional role, and that meant she couldn't either She couldn't be too much of an advocate for the kids because she'd be going beyond the mandate of the nonprofit. But she had to do at least what to have something where the kids would accept her, and she went to an enormous amount of trouble to make damn certain that those young people wanted her to be there and that she wasn't forcing herself on. Right? And she's documented that really nicely. It turns out that the role that she takes is the role, because it turns out that in the young people learning how to negotiate power relations where they're big underdogs with respect to the superintendent, in order just to be able to get to the table and talk, there's a lot that they have to learn. They're going to have to learn some procedures and ways of doing things that if they don't learn and they just want to go out and raise trouble, they'll get whatever they get that way. But if they want to actually have a voice in the system directly and not indirectly through protest, they're going to have to learn how to do this kind of stuff. And it turns out one of the things that's really useful to learn is that somebody takes notes of the meeting so that at the next meeting, you read the notes of the last meeting. Very standard. Our department's not very good at it, but it's a very standard procedure in large organizations. Angela positions herself as the note taker. Now, if you're an ethnographer and you want to get field notes about what it is that's going on and you want them to be authentic field notes, what better position than being there as a note taker in the conversation between the kids? Right. So she's not disturbing this, but she herself has to be constantly doing this dance between the different players and their different expectations for what the youth are supposed to do, and how can she balance herself in playing this role in a proper democratic fashion. In all of the adjustments that she has to make, it teaches her an enormous amount. It's made visible to her the internal tensions of the student group.